Hello and welcome to my talk. I'm Alexandre Belloni and today I will be speaking about supporting audio on an embedded system. This is actually an update of my 2016 Embedded Linux Conference Europe talk, and since then quite a lot changed. I'm an embedded Linux engineer at Bootlean. And Bootlean is a consulting company. We are providing development services, consulting and training to our customers. We are heavily focusing on the Linux kernel itself, but also some bootloaders and build systems. I'm also an open source contributor. I'm the maintainer for the Linux kernel RTC subsystem, and I'm also the co-maintainer for the microchips, ARM, and MIPS SoCs. I've been doing quite a lot of audio work for customers, and that's why I'm speaking about that now. So the anatomy of an embedded system would be: on one side, you would get the SoC. The SoC will get two different kind of connections to a codec. And that codec will either output analog audio directly to a connector or maybe through an amplifier. So the two kinds of connection will be first the configuration connection, so that will be I2C or SPI typically, but that can also be for example, the I/O memory directly on the SoC. And the second kind of connection will be the digital audio connection, and we'll see a bit more in depth what this is about. So, like I said, the codec configuration will happen on a simple serial bus, usually I2C and SPI. And the SoC digital audio interface is also sometimes called a synchronous serial interface. It's the one that will provide the audio data to the codec, and it has multiple formats. I'll go through those formats a bit later. The examples for those SoC digital audio interfaces will be the Atmel SSC, so that will be the synchronous serial controller, the NXP SSI or SAI, and you also have the TI MC ASP, and you will have some SoCs that also have a separate SPDIF controller. The amplifier itself is totally optional. You can have some line in or line out connection. Some SoCs like the Atmel SAMe5D2 will have the codec and the amplifier directly on the SoC, so that will typically be a Class D amplifier. So the signals for the DAI will be two different clocks, so that will be BCLK, the bit clock, and WCLK, that will be the frame or sync clock. And then you will get one or multiple data connections, that will be TX and RAX, or for the codec, that will be data in and data out. Like I was saying, the digital audio interface is a serial interface. It uses two clocks. The bit clock is usually called BCK or BCLK in the datasheet, and the frame clock is often called FCLK, FSCK, FSCLK, or sometimes it refers as the left-right clock, so that will be LRCK or LRCLK, or even you can see also the word clock, so that will be WCLK in that case. So the rate of the frame clock is really the sample rate, and it's also called FS. So that will really be the sample rate of your audio sample that you are trying to play or to record. There is a relationship between BCK and FSCK, that will be the bit clock is actually the frame clock, multiplied by the number of channels and multiplied by the bit depth, that will be the sample size. And then the DAI also has one or multiple data lines, and we'll see that you will possibly get more than two data lines. So you also have a separate clock, so that will be a third clock, MCLK, that can be also referred as the system clock or CCLK. That will be a clock that goes to the codec, and that's what the codec needs to be working. Some codecs will also require that MCLK or system clock to be able to use the control interface, so just know that sometimes you really need to be able to provide that clock before even playing an audio file or a sample. So that clock can be provided by the SoC when it has that kind of output, or if you are using a system on module, if your system on module is also providing a pin with that clock, or you can also use a crystal. If you don't have any of those, some codecs are able to use BCLK or the frame clock as their codec clocks, as their system clock, and that will make MCLK optional. Usually, the codecs will expect MCLK to be a multiple of BCLK, and usually it will be specified as a multiple of FS, so you may see that MCLK should be 256 FS, for example. Some other codecs will have plenty of divisor or PLLs to be able to adjust that system clock to BCLK. It kind of depends on the codec. One DAI, so either the SoC DAI or the codec DAI, will be responsible to generate the bit clock. It will be the bit clock master, and one DAI will be responsible to generate the frame clock, that will be the frame master. So the bit clock master and the frame master doesn't have to be the same DAI, but that's usually the case. But well, you can see some use cases where you will see, for example, the bit clock provided by the codec, and then the frame clock provided by the SoC, and that should be perfectly working. So the codec usually have a great set of PLLs and dividers, that what I was saying just before, and that will allow you to get a precise BCLK from many different MCLK rates. So it's usually more flexible to have the codec as the bit clock master and frame clock master. However, now what you can see is that some SoCs have specialized audio PLLs, and that's usually the case of the modern SoCs. That's the case for the IMX 6, 7, and 8, for example. You also have that on the SAMe5D2 now, and TI also have that on some of their SoC now. If you have that, then it's perfectly fine to actually use your SoC as the master, as long as you can generate the proper bit clock, and we will have some example later. So I said that the codecs may have multiple data ins and data out lines, and they may have up to one line per channel pair, and usually that's done when you have multiple channel outputs, let's say more than two. The example I have there with the analog devices AD1937 is that it has eight outputs in four pairs, and that means that for that you can actually have four data inlines. So that allows you to simply have four different left-right pairs on four different data ins. This is multiplying the number of pins that you need and routing to the SoC, but it allows you to avoid doing TDM, so time division multiplexing. And some codecs may also have multiple DAIs, that means that they will have one full interface for data in and one full interface for data out, so they will have two times the bit clock and frame clock. So that's also the case for that AD1937, and in that case you can see that it has DBCLK and DLRCLK. Those will be the data in, so in the D there means digital, so that will be the digital bit clock and digital frame clock, and it goes with the four data in lines, and so you can get up to 8 outputs from that codec, so 8 analog outputs from that codec. And so that codec also has 4 analog inputs, and that in that case you would use the ABCLK and ALRCLK, that would be the analog bit clock and analog frame clock. And you also have up to 2 data out lines, and so that will be analog in and data out. So the digital formats that go over those lines are, for example, left justified, and in that case, what you get is that you have the bit clock going, and then the left right clock. In that case, we have left level high and right level low on the LR clock, so in the frame clock, and then the data in or out is starting as soon as you have a change of level on that clock. You can notice there that this is usually what is done by the codecs. You can have more bit clocks than the actual data, meaning that usually what you can do is have 32 bit clocks and only, for example, 16 or 24 bits of data to transmit. And what the codec will do is basically just ignore the superfluous bits that you sent. It doesn't matter because thanks to the frame clock, which is also, as you remember, named frame sync, it will always be able to sync again and to know when the MSB of the data is starting. Then you have write justified, and write justified does the opposite. It will first ignore the starting bits and then get the last bits as actual data. This is more convenient for the codec because it has more time to prepare the DAC or ADC, but it's also less convenient to configure because then you actually have to configure the number of bits to ignore. You also have I2S, which is the usual format that you will see when you are doing only left and right. And in that case, it really looks like left justified, but everything is just shifting from one bit clock. So you have to remember that. It's not that important when you are reusing existing codec drivers or SoC DI drivers. But that may be an issue when you are writing a codec driver. So be careful with that. Also, the left and right have a different polarity. So in that case, you will have left low and right high. DSPA, which is only syncing for one bit clock, and then you are waiting that bit clock, and the data is starting, and that data will have the exact length of your sample, and the right channel will just follow the left channel. Then you have DSP-B that looks like a lot like DSP-A, but you don't have that 1 bit bit clock delay. And in that case, also for DSP-B, the impulse on the frame clock may be longer than 1 bit clock. You just have to have a 1 bit clock low between two samples. And then you can combine that with TDM. So usually on TDM you will get TDM left justify or TDM I square S, which are the most common configurations that you will find. And so what you do there is that you still use the frame sync as your main sync, but then you will let's say cram multiple channels in the same side. In that case, really the left-right clock width doesn't matter much. It can usually can it also can be only 1 bit clock, and then you have as many bit clock as you need. So to be able to send all your channels. And in that example, you see exactly that.
So
So
basically,
basically
what
what
you
you
see
see
is
is
that
that
you
you
have
have
32 bit clocks per channel, but you actually have only 24 bits of data. Right. So that means that you will get in total that will be TDM 8. So you have 8 times 32, that's 256 bit clock for one frame clock. And then finally, you have final format that is completely different. In that case, you have only two signals per channel. It's not unusual DI, but we are starting to see it more and more, especially with the kind of assistants that you get, like Alexa or Google Assistant, that are using microphone arrays. You have so PDM, which is encoding audio a bit differently, and that in that case, that the pulse width is actually dependent on the analog level. So it's completely different, but you can get that kind of format, which until now was quite rare, but we are starting to see it. So to handle all of that, we have a subsystem. It is based, well, it is a subsystem of the kernel, but it's also a subsystem of ALSA. ALSA, it is the usual Linux sound architecture, and we have then ASOC, that means ALSA for system on chips, and it has been created a while ago now to provide better ALSA for system on chips and to actually be able to reuse codec drivers across multiple architectures instead of each architecture or each SoC vendor having their own driver for similar codecs. So it provides two different APIs, one API to write codec drivers and one API to write SoC interface drivers. So and then obviously you will have to glue those two drivers, right? So the components for the ASOC
subsystem are the codec class drivers that are defining the codec capabilities. So that's the first defining what is available as the DAI, so as the digital audio interface. And then it also defines the analog inputs, the analog outputs that you have. And finally, you also get the audio control. So basically, the most basic control that you will get will be muting and changing the volume of your analog input and output. But some codecs will have more advanced controls, like muxing, actually muxing channels, saying, okay, I want channel 0 of my digital input to go on channel 4, for example. Or maybe some codecs will be able to mix their input on output. So you will get controls to do that. Then you have some platform class drivers that will define the SoC audio interface, so that's what I usually call the CPU, DAI, and it defines the same audio interface capabilities, and obviously at some point the ASOC will be matching the capabilities from the codec with the capabilities from the platform to understand whether it is able to play some kind of audio samples. The platform class driver, so from the SoC, will also set up DMA when applicable, and usually you will be using DMA because you don't want to copy all the audio samples from memory or from your file to the DAA FIFO. So usually DMA will be involved. And finally, you have some codec to platform integration. Nowadays, it's usually done through device tree, and previously it was requiring writing a machine driver in C, and that machine driver will register a sound card. That was the topic of my 2016 ELT talk, so I will let you, if you really need to write a machine driver, I will let you have a look at that talk. It has been recorded, it's available online. And there is a note there that the codec can be part of another IC. Usually what you see on really embedded system or phones or that kind of thing, you will find that as part of the PMIC, or some will have that as part of the Bluetooth or modem chips. So yeah, the codec can be part of anything. It can be a separate codec, but it can also be on another IC. So let's have a look at how to support that using device tree. So now most of the sound cards can be described using a simple audio card. So, and that will be using the simple card driver. So the device tree bindings are documented in simplecard.yaml. So it has been converted to YAML recently. And the driver handling that will be in SoundSock generic simple card. Since 2017, you also have an OFGraph based binding that is available. It's documented in audiographcard.txt. And the driver that will be handling that is SoundSock generic audiographcard.c, which is a bit different, but it's still less common currently, but yeah, it's definitely usable. Both of those required a few changes in the SOC DAI driver to be actually usable as is, and the changes that have been made will be, for example, selecting audio mode on the Atmel SSC, or now I'm saying the microchip SoCs, Because the SSE can work as a simple serial interface, but it has to be set to audio mode. And before, you had to actually always write your own machine driver just to be able to change that mode. And for example, the IMX has a kind of same issue, where you have to you have a separate muxing interface for the audio signals, where you can say, okay, the audio from that controller is going to those pins, and so this has to be configured. And now the OutMux driver is able to do that when you are using a simple card. So let's see an example. Let's say that we have an ADAU 1372 connected on an IMX6 UL-SAI. And so the first step will be just to enable the SAI and the codec. And in that case, it's quite simple. You just say, SAI2, I will enable that. You use the usual pin control for SAI2, and that's pretty much it. And for the codec, in that case, it is connected on I2C, in that case, the I2C1 controller, and it is at location 0x3C. And it takes an input clock, and that input clock is MCLK, so that's the system clock. In that case, it has to be named MCLK, so that's what we did there. And in our case, what we have is a crystal, so the crystal is also defined there. It is a fixed clock going at 12.288 MHz. So that's pretty much it, and it's defining enabling our CPU DAI, that is the SAI in that case, and our codec. So now let's describe the sound card. The sound card in our case will be simple audio card. You can give it a name. So that's basically what we did there. So simple audio card name, simple name IMX6UL ADAU 1372. And now we have to define how the link is down, so between our two DAIs, so that will be simple audio card DAI link. In our case, we only have one DAI link, so you just have to know that you can avoid having that subnode, but well, it's a better practice to actually have it. We'll be using the I2S format, and the bit clock master is the ADAU, so that's the codec, and that's more convenient, and because we know that it will be able to generate both the bit clock and the frame clock from MCLK. So that's as simple as that. We have a CPU subnode and the DAI link subnode. And that one refers to the SAI, so that definitely means this is our CPU DAI. And then we have a codec subnode, and that one refers to the codec node. They have been named, but the name doesn't really matter. What matters is that the they have some aliases, and the alias doesn't matter, but what really matters is the CPU name for that node and the codec name for the codec node. So that's perfectly enough to have audio playing. If you do a play with that, audio will be perfectly working. It will be using I2S and everything will be fine. So let's go a bit further, because that codec actually has 4 channels, so it has 4 input channels and 2 output channels, and if you want to be able to use those 4 input channels, then you will have to do TDM, and in that case it's quite simple. We are just saying, okay, DAI TDM slot num is 4, and we will also set the width to 32, and in that case we will always be using 32 bit sample width, and the codec will happily ignore all the bits that are superfluous or whatever you send that is not from your sample. So that's pretty much it, and in that case you will just have four channels of 32 bits, and it's still using the I2S format, and that will be perfectly working. Until you realize, for our third example, until you realize that the codec has an hardware issue and it will not be able to generate the proper bit clock when doing TDM4 and with a 32K sample rate. So in that case, we change everything, and instead of having the codec as master, we just switch to have the CPU as master. So it should be as simple as changing the bit clock master and frame master. That's what I did there. Now I'm referring to the SAI to DAI. So should be working, right? But unfortunately, the result is not really what you expect. When you try to play an audio file at 32 kHz, it's still complaining that it's unable to install the hardware parameters, and looking at the kernel log will show you what's happening. In that case, the SRI is complaining that it's failing to derive the required bit clock, and it's saying, okay, the bit clock is 4 MHz, right? And let's have a look at the clock tree, and with the after mounting debugfs. So the CLK summary will show you something like that. I removed all the clocks that were not interested, but the clock tree up to SAI2 looks like that. And basically you see that the clock that is feeding the SAI, well, there is no way for the SAI to actually divide that clock to get the proper BCLK, because, well, there is no, the SAI just have a small number of dividers, and nothing is fitting to divide the clock to get to the 4 MHz clock that we want. So let's solve that. It's actually possible to solve that using device tree, and in that case we want to both reparent the clock using the assign clock parents and property, and then to set the clock rate using assign clock rates. Just so that you know, the IMX6 UL has an audio PLL, so PLL4 is actually the audio PLL, and it has all the rates that you would want to be able to generate 32K, 44.1K, 48K, for example. And so that's the one you definitely want to use. So in that case, what we do is that we say, okay, the SAI2 cell, that will be the MUX selector for the SAI2. That selector, we say, okay, its parent will be the PLL4 audio div, right? And its clock rate is set to, well, that's 196 MHz, about. And then we have the SAI2 clock that we want to set to 24.576 MHz, and that is selected because the SAI is not able to divide by 3. It's only able to divide by 2, 4, and 6. So it's not able to divide, for example, 12.288 and to get the 4 megahertz clock, right? So, and that will, well, after doing that, so this is assigning the clocks and everything in the SAI node. After doing that, you will get audio working, so that will be solving your clock issues. Now you have the fourth example, you have a possible cost reduction and where the SAI is able to output its clock to feed the codec. So if you want to remove the crystal from the board, it's possible, and then you will well, save a few cents or a few dollars because you don't have to have that crystal on the board. So in that case, you will be assigning the clocks in the codec node, and this is the exact same assignment that we had before. You have to do it in the codec node because you have to ensure that when the codec is probing, that's when it will try to get its MCLK rate, and you have to have it set before the codec is probing. And because of the probe order, you are not sure that the SAI will actually probe before the codec, so you have to then now assign the clock in the codec node. So the other thing that changed is that the clocks doesn't refer to the crystal anymore, but it refers to the actual SAI clock, and that's pretty much it. Now you are feeding the SAI clock to the codec. There is one property that is specific to Freescale, so that's FSL SAI MCLK direction output, to say that that particular pin is used as an output. So now there is something that we did there, is that we have replaced a 12 MHz crystal to a 24 MHz clock, and this is actually working because the codec, that particular codec, has a configurable divider for MCLK, and it can actually divide it by 2. So, well, we found a solution with the SAI as master and without a crystal, so that's fine. So something that you can do, and that is not mandatory, when you were writing your machine driver, it was mandatory to do it, but using a simple audio card, you don't have to do it. It's routing, and so that will be listing or describing the actual audio connections that are present on the board. And the first step there will be to define the board connectors. So you use the simple audio card widget property, and then you have some pairs of strings there, that will be the type and the name that you want to give to your particular widget. So then you have to route your audio from the codec to your board connectors, and this will be done using the simple audio card routing property, and this is also done with pairs of strings, and this will be sync and source. So in that case, you have the analog ins of the codec, so A in 0, and the source for that will be line 0. You have 2 because line 0 is a stereo jack, so you have 2, and they are going to 2 different channels on the codec, and that's the same for line 1, that is there multiple times, and it's also going to 2 different analog input for the codec. And then for the output, you have the headphone jack, so that will be your sync, and in that case, that's my widget, and the HP out L and HP out R are coming from the codec, so that's basically the headphone output left and right channel. If you want to know what the codec is providing and what are the names that you should use there, you just have to look for the SoundSock DAPM output and SoundSock DAPM input macros and definitions in your codec driver. So, what about the amplifier? If you have an amplifier on your board, well, it is supported using the auxiliary devices, and there is a driver for simple amplifier when they are driven by a single GPIO, which will be the usual case for amplifiers. So let's have a look at that. With switch examples, I took an example from the mainline kernel. So in that case, the simple audio amplifier is used. That's the first thing that is defined. And it has something interesting. It has a sound name prefix that will give the name for the widgets that you can actually use later when routing. And that's what you see in that sound node. You have the audio routing that is there, that is reusing the AU2 name. In that case, you have two ins and two out, outs. So AU2 in L, AU2 in R, so this will be the input, and AU2 out L and AU2 out R will be the output. And in that case, you see that the inputs of the amplifier are connected to the codec output, and the output of the amplifier will be connected to the jack, or the, in that case, the line out widget that will be from the board. Then that will route your audio through that amplifier. So let's talk about troubleshooting. What you can have is that audio seems to play for the correct duration. You just use time, for example, and to know whether a play did play for the correct amount of time, and you may not have any sound. And usually it's an issue when with the ASA control. So that's usually what you will get. You need to unmute master and the relevant control, so that may be digital, for example. And then you want to turn up the volume. You want to check your codec analog muxing and mixing, and that's exactly what could happen. So maybe you are listening for one channel, and it has actually the channel has been muxed to another output inside the codec, and so that's something you have to check. You also want to check the amplifier configuration, and obviously you want to check your routing. Just know that also for the controls, that's the case for the ADAU 1372 codec that I used as an example. The default values for the controls are not doing anything, so they basically have some invalid muxing there. So you definitely want to set your own muxing when using that codec. You can also have no sound, but then a play will be stuck, and so or it will time out. Then you definitely want to check pin muxing, and because that definitely means that there is an issue in your DAI's configuration. So check your pin muxing, check your configured clock direction, who is the master, who is the slave, and whether the pin conf for the pins for the SoCs are the correct ones. Definitely you want to be able to check the clocks using an oscilloscope. Is your BCLK at the correct rate? Is your frame clock at the correct rate? Are they in sync? And then you want to check the data. Is the data what you would expect regarding the sync and the bit clock. Usually data and bit clocks are pretty much okay, but what you really want to check is whether the data is in sync with the frame clock. And then check pin mixing again, because it's always pin mixing. And like I said just before, some SoCs will have more mixing, so check the OddMux or the MCASP mixing, because that, well, you may not be sending audio or your signals to the correct controller. You can also get that kind of write error, so input-output error. That's usually caused by an issue in the routing. Something that I had, even with an upstream driver, was that the driver was not exposing a stream named playback, and that's basically the stream that ALSA will look for to be able to play audio. So if it's not there, then nothing will work. You can use VisDAPM, which will provide a graph of all your widgets that are enabled, and you will have a nice graph with everything that is enabled and disabled, and it will allow you to debug whether your routes are working well or whether you have an issue in your codec driver, for example. Finally, you will want to troubleshoot the overruns and underruns. They may be caused obviously by a media that is too slow, whether when recording or when playing audio, but it can also be caused by an imprecise BCLK, and in that case you will want to try to find a better PLL and divider combination, just so that your BCLK will be more precise, which is not always easy or possible. Or maybe you will just have to live with your underruns. Troubleshooting a bit further, then you will want to have to know, well, to have a look at what the CPU DAA driver is doing, the callback of interest. There are setCLK div, setCCLK, because that will set up the clock dividers, and then the main one, main interesting one, will be HW params. That's where basically the whole setup for your stream is done, and that's what you want to look for. SetDAA format will also be of interest. Because that's where you set left justified, I square S, right justified, or whatever format you are using there. So if you have an issue with your format, you want to look at that. The same thing will happen in the codec driver callbacks, where you have set CCLK, and in that case you want to look at how the clock is set, if you have an issue with your codec not generating the bit clock properly, because like I said, some codecs will be able to generate the bit clocks from their system clock, or maybe from the bit clock or the frame clock. In that case, that's something you will want, or you will have to configure, and that will be CLK ID parameter there. That will be definitely codec specific. So remember that using the codec as slave is uncommon, and sometimes it's just untested, and well, you may have an upstream driver and maybe nobody ever used it as a slave, and so this will just not be working. And when in doubt, that's what I usually do when bringing up a platform. I'm using DevMem to set the DAI configuration that I want, and I2C get or I2C set to set the codec DAI configuration, which allows you to do that while playing a stream. And so Well, it's convenient because when you get the proper configuration doing that, then you just have to have a look at what's needed from the driver to set that configuration. Going further, once your kernel and device tree part are working, usually what you will want to do is split, let's say TDM 8 or 4, so when you have 4 channel input or 8 channel input or output, you will want to split that in individual channels or maybe in pair of channels, because usually what you get is stereo audio or mono audio. And this can be done efficiently in user space, and you will be able to do that using AlsaLib, and I will just send you to our blog that is describing exactly that, and it's describing how to do that efficiently and not have too much mixing happening. So references, documentation from the kernel is quite okay, not always what you look for, but well, you have some information there. You have a document from analog devices describing the common digital interface, and you have the I2S specification, which is kind of the base of everything. So I'm available if you have more questions, I will be able to answer them. Thank you.